This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
What's happening, friends? Welcome to Podcast Unlocked. It is episode 486 for March. What is this? I have the date wrong in the notes. It's March 16th, not the 9th. March 16th, 2021. I'm Ryan McCaffrey, pleased to be joined, as always, by Miranda Sanchez.
Hi, hello. Welcome, everybody.
Cam Hawkins.
Hey, Ryan, how's it going?
Hello, hello, and welcoming back new dad, Destin LaDaddy.
Bam! Hey, everybody. I was hoping you would say Dadston, because you said Dadston. That earlier, and I was like, please use Dadston.
There's a few different ways we could go with it. Yeah, your name lends itself well. Well, Destin, welcome back. How is dad life treating you so far?
It's good. It's a lot of work. The baby didn't sleep very good last night. So, you know, you have those days, Ryan, you probably know. Have those days where the baby sleeps 3 hours at a time, and then you do a feeding, and then 3 hours, and then you have nights when it just doesn't sleep. Baby just doesn't sleep. So yeah, but he is amazing. It's like you have those really, really challenging days, but then he just smiles at you and you're like, it's all worth it. Like nothing else. It doesn't matter. You know, it's really, really, really incredible to be a dad. I like it more than I thought I would, even with the challenges and like the scary stuff. And yeah, it's awesome. I love that little guy.
Not too much scary stuff.
No, but like a lot of babies when they're born, they have jaundice. So our baby had a little bit of jaundice. So we had to have like bilirubin tests and you know, dad stuff, parent stuff. He's fine now. He's totally good.
Smile and say yes.
You've been out for like a couple months now. And so I'm curious, you know, you've got all that. You're not working at all. You've got the paternity leave time. It's time with your new family. But did you find any game time in there at all? Or was it just anytime the baby was sleeping, you were sleeping too?
I gamed quite a bit. I started like recently. I'm trying to commit to playing on the Xbox Series S for a week just to kind of get an idea of what that would be like as an Xbox Series S gamer and the limitations of the console. And I've been pleasantly surprised. It's better than I you know, expected. And I think people playing on that platform, well, anyway, I could talk about that after the week's over, but I've had a really, really wonderful time using the console, and man, it's just such a good entry. I'm really excited to be on today's episode to talk about everything that I've been thinking about and all the news that's been happening lately, Ryan. Xbox has been on fire.
There's a lot to get to this week, and you know, you've got a hard out in like an hour from now, so you know, you're just you're excited to talk, but only for so long before you fail us again. Real quick, two quick things. One housekeeping note, one fun thing. So let's do the housekeeping note first. Once again, IGN Games, our new YouTube channel, that is now where Unlocked lives on YouTube. YouTube.com/IGN Games. Destin, that's one of the things that changed while you were gone. Unlocked YouTube channel is no longer being updated. The shows are not being published there. So please subscribe to us on YouTube if you prefer to watch rather than listen. Of course, on podcast, nothing's changed. We're on all of your favorite podcast services. But we would very much encourage you to watch. And you can do so on youtube.com/IGN Games, the new home for all of the IGN shows. There is an Unlocked playlist, so you can just use that if you're not interested in any of the other shows. But we hope maybe you will be. All right, real quick, Miranda Sanchez, we have a longtime Unlocked listener, sweetheart of a guy. He goes by the gamertag Jimbo Jangles. When Maggie, the boxer, passed away, he completely unsolicited made and sent me this, which I it's been on a shelf. I look at it all the time. On the back, it says, in memory of Maggie. I've always treasured this. Just out of the goodness of his heart, he reached out to me and said, hey, how can I get something special to Miranda, an Xbox controller? Don't tell her, surprise. So that has been arranged. We had to do some mail juggling because IGN's moving offices anyway. No one cares about that. But the point is, can you show the incredible controller that was custom made for you by Jimbo Jangle?
This is actually a dream. Gasped. So if you guys are listening, what I am showing right now is a super, sleek custom Xbox Pikachu controller. And when I say sleek, I mean it. Like this, it's not even just like a decal. Like this is on the controller. It looks so good. The share button is Pikachu's nose, so you get to give it a little boop when you want to share. I love how all of the buttons are just like blacked out. So I know where the buttons are. I know A, B, X, Y are. And I don't need that. So they're just like, looks so good blacked out. And then I turned it around and I was just like, what? Because there's a Pokemon.
That's so cool.
Red triggers.
That's so good.
Yeah, it is immensely good. And not only that, he was so kind. Jimbo, thank you so very much. Also, 3D printed me a little stand for it so it matches. Oh, and it has my username on it. I don't have anything with my username on it. So it was just like, oh, this is super special. So thank you so much. It's incredibly kind of you. And I don't know how I'm going to use any other controller. Oh, I didn't even see this before. Oh my gosh, there's my username right here.
Okay, oh, that's anyway. So cool.
Excuse me, we're getting to the high pitches. Thank you so very much. It's incredibly kind. Yeah,
that's amazing.
This guy's so sweet, so kind-hearted. He told me, you know, he reached out to me to try and get that controller to you, but it turns out he sent two, and I have not opened mine yet. I took one thing out of it, so I'm going to do that real quick right now. I took one thing out of the package, and this gives a pretty strong hint as to the content. So this is a 3D printer, which is really cool. He did such a great job on that Tesla logo, so let me just pop this open real quick. This is the first time I'm seeing this. Oh, it's taped. Hold on.
Yeah, I will vamp a little bit.
But packing it up. Let me not stab myself. Hang on a second.
Dustin, what's the first game you're going to make your baby play?
Make him play?
Kingdom Hearts.
My wife doesn't really want to expose him to TV and stuff until he's a little bit older. So it's going to be years out.
Yeah.
I have no idea, Miranda. Like, who knows?
I mean, Kingdom Hearts has Disney in it. Kingdom Hearts has Disney in it. I think it's a very good, you know what I'm saying?
No.
Hey, Ryan, your Denver buddy.
I had to try.
I know your 10-year anniversary at IGN is right around the corner. It's actually 9, but we'll just pretend it's 10. So I thought I would have a little something made to say thanks for all the hard work you've done in continuing to bring me Unlocked every week, despite all the craziness that's going on out there. I hope you enjoy the gift. And if you want to reach out to let me know you received this, well, that's what we're doing right now. Yeah. If you want to follow him on Instagram, Jimbo_Jangles, JANGLEZ. Have a great day, Ryan. And let me just pop this open. That is cool. Oh, check this out. This is really sweet. That is cool. And there's like a custom, silver. It's like a steering wheel, kind of texture grip on the sides.
What?
And on the back, it says made for DMC Ryan, 1 of 1, like a sort of, you know, that is awesome. That's Jimbo. Amazing. Thank you so much.
And Jimbo, if you really don't have a little store for these, you might want to consider that.
I don't even want to use it because I don't want to mess it up. It's just, I might have to just display it, but
wow.
Jimbo, great stuff. We have amazing fans and viewers and listeners out there. Thank you all so very much. We love you guys. I mean, we're thrilled. This is the highlight of my work week, is getting to do this podcast, because it's actually the only time I get to actually look at my coworkers. The rest of the time we're just kind of on Slack and stuff. So, oh man, great stuff. That's got me in a great mood. So let's move on and talk about, I do want to talk about the Xbox wireless headset. But I want to get everybody involved in the I'm the only one that has it at the moment. So let's start with the other big topic, and then I'll talk about the wireless headset. Let's talk again about Bethesda and Microsoft, because they are continuing to make news together. They held a roundtable live stream. Aaron Greenberg, marketing guru, Phil Spencer, head of Xbox, flew out to Bethesda. And obviously everybody was, I'm sure, tested and saved. And they had everybody in a nice big round table room at Bethesda in Maryland, along with Pete Hines, Todd Howard, Aaron Losey, who runs PR and comms there. And then they just talked through, like, hey, what does this acquisition, what does this relationship mean? And I want to go around the room, because this was, I thought when they announced this really last minute, it was, I think, the day before, or might have even been the day of, they announced this. Oh, we're going to live stream at 10 a.m. Meet the Bethesda team. And I thought it would be 20 minutes. It was an hour and 20 minutes. They covered a lot of ground. They introduced literally every Bethesda studio. So Destin, you haven't had a chance to talk Xbox for a while. I want to go to you first. What did you think of that presentation?
It was perfect. It was absolutely great. And I think they revealed that this is more than just about the acquisition of Bethesda. I see the focus for the talking point here is about the exclusivity angle. But for me, one of the bigger takeaways is id Tech. They talked about integrating id Tech with 343. They talked about, you know, how they can utilize that with the Coalition. And the fact that there's going to be more collaboration there between those teams, they also have the mobile branches. There's the whole Japan angle with how they're going to be able to better integrate with some Japan games as they have, Ghostwire Tokyo?
Right. Yeah, that's the
what's the name of the studio? Tango Gameworks, right?
Tango Gameworks.
Yeah, so Tango Gameworks in Japan now is part of it. So this acquisition and this presentation made it a lot clearer to me about where they saw the value of that $7.5 billion. And do you want to save the quote or do you want me to talk about it really quick?
Get to that in a minute. Because I'm glad you brought up id Tech because I actually forgot that in my notes, even though I had tweeted about it. Because, yeah, it's you hit it on the head is Phil Spencer himself specifically called out, hey, it's so many words. We really like id Tech. We really like that engine.
Yeah.
And he mentioned, as you said, the Coalition and 343. And id Tech, for anybody in the audience that isn't familiar, that is the game engine that powers Doom. It powers Wolfenstein. And it's not confirmed, but seemingly will be probably powering the Indiana Jones game as well, since that's Machine's next project. It is it has proven itself to be an incredibly adept and also, what's the word I want here, Destin? Very efficient.
It's very powerful and optimized. Yeah.
Thank you, optimized. That's really the, because it runs like a champ while still looking incredible. If you've played Doom Eternal, you know exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, it's just a high performance engine, both in terms of frame rate, but in terms of texture quality and just overall visual fidelity. It looks phenomenal. So, you know, don't expect Halo Infinite to suddenly have the space engine ripped out and have id Tech put in. That's not going to be happening, but there are some really intriguing possibilities for that moving forward. Cam, what were your overall impressions of the presentation?
I really, really liked it. I think that one of the things I really appreciated was just kind of the studio to studio relationships that Bethesda had, like where they would just go and like they would show off the games to each other and just and show what they're working on. And like just thinking of that idea of being able to see that same thing happen, but in a bigger, like in a bigger way, with them now being a part of Xbox Game Studios, seeing all these other studios that Xbox already has acquired and just everyone showing off each other's games just gets me really excited for just Xbox Game Studios as a whole, because I think it gives those studios the inspiration to like work harder, give themselves like the ideas and implement maybe ideas that they see from other games and in, like implement them into their games. And again, like similar to what you guys were saying before, the ability now to share Bethesda's technology with Xbox Game Studios and vice versa. I think that there's just a lot of really potentially great things that can happen with this new acquisition that Xbox has with Bethesda.
I thought the sort of my big takeaway from it was that it was really, the messaging to me was, hey, we didn't just buy Elder Scrolls and Fallout. There's a lot more to Bethesda and there's a lot of talent here. What were your thoughts on it?
Me, at least, I think just to that point, too, is like this is so much about an introduction. Like, hey, we know Bethesda as like these two big things and maybe a few other things here, but like kind of doing the handshakes with everybody else. Like, everyone go around the room, say who's joining the family, just so you get a little bit more background. And to your point about collaboration, before. We actually talked about all that a little bit last week as far as like team support and whatever other things that might happen. And they're not necessarily talking about that, but knowing that at least as a technology and information sharing is already such a big front thing, I think that bodes really well for what Microsoft already has. No one would like to see that, right? I think you get so much innovation out of like working together and finding new ideas and implementing them in different ways, and it could only make your team stronger. So
hearing Todd also discuss the relationship that he and Phil have had, like we talked about Fallout 76 and how bad that launch was and how they're already calling Xbox and Microsoft to be like, you know, what do we do wrong? Do you have any advice here? And they've been collaborating so much already. Mm-hmm. So to hear the inverse, like from the Bethesda perspective, it seems genuine. Like Todd has no
absolutely.
I guess he has a little bit of a reason, $7.5 billion. But I mean, it seems genuine, right? Like he doesn't seem like he's being forced to say nice things. It's just the truth. Hey, we had a terrible Fallout 76 launch. I called my buddy Phil Spencer and we worked some stuff out. And I played that game on the Series S. That's one of the games I played during break, Ryan. And they've made some pretty big improvements. And I think later on, we're going to talk about the games being added to Game Pass and like, they pushed the FPS boost yesterday. So now all those games are running at like 60. And that's really, really interesting too. I don't know if you're going to bring it up later, but there's also the summer event where we're going to learn more about the conversation we're going to have about exclusivity.
No, good of you to mention it. So whatever shape that takes, whether it's going to be during the digital E3 or just sometime a little later in the summer, we will be hearing more from Bethesda. And then the question is, that's when the game announcements are sure to start. There's really a lot here. They kept it rolling by making a number of additions to Game Pass, 20 of them. In fact, Destin just mentioned one of them in Fallout 76. So a whole pile of Bethesda games are now available in Xbox Game Pass. You've got Dishonored 1 and 2. The original Doom and Doom 2, which warms my heart, that because those games, that's a Mount Rushmore game for me. You know, four games, put them on a mountain. That Doom is on it, and the game's still fun. And now you can just play it for free on Game Pass, and it still feels great. Doom and Doom 2, Doom 64, Doom 3, Doom Eternal. Strangely, Doom 2016 is not on this list for some reason, but I'm sure there must be a reason. Fallout New Vegas.
Isn't that just because it's already on it?
Is it? Oh, then that's a good reason.
That probably is.
That's a good reason. Yes, New Vegas, beloved role-playing game. Fallout 4, Fallout 76. Prey, which I think is a game that really deserves kind of a second life.
Spooky. It's so cool, though.
Where your coffee mug might attack you in Prey, which in the very best of ways. Rage 2, which is super solid. And then you rock the Elder Scrolls line, Morrowind coming back from the OG Xbox, Oblivion, which is my personal favorite in the series, Skyrim, of course, the Elder Scrolls Online, which I started playing over the weekend after hearing Phil Spencer talk it up.
I did too. Ryan, we should play together.
Let's do that, please. Yeah, let's absolutely do that. That would make it a lot more fun for me. And then The Evil Within, which is Tango Gameworks. Destin was mentioning Tango earlier. That's Shinji Mikami. You've got, and then the Wolfenstein, the New Order, Wolfenstein, the Old Blood, Wolfenstein, the Young Blood. And of those, all but Morrowind, Oblivion, Elder Scrolls Online, and New Vegas are also available through Cloud Play if you're on Game Pass Ultimate. So just Game Pass leveled up big time overnight. Yeah. And Destin alluding to another thing earlier, FPS boost for five of these games as well. On the Series X, you've got Skyrim Special Edition up to 60 frames, Fallout 4, the aforementioned Fallout 76, Dishonored Definitive Edition, and Prey as well. Mm-hmm. So just great, great stuff.
The fact that there's two MMOs on there, MMORPGs with Fallout 76 and Elder Scrolls Online, like that alone is just a pretty astounding value that you can just... Hey, you can just play Fallout 76 with Game Pass, and that's 1,000 hours alone for one property. So when you start talking about the value of Game Pass, it's just anybody who is hating on Game Pass, just I don't understand you.
I don't think I've heard anybody hate on it.
No. Like, I don't know why anybody would ever hate on this service, because it is such a tremendous value for families. Like, if you could only buy 2 games a year, just get Game Pass, because you get hundreds of games. And like, yes, sometimes a game is added like a month or two after it's been out. But like something like Outriders getting announced as joining Game Pass, that's another game that you could put 1,000 hours into, just grinding out weapons and everything. So the value of that service, it's just a no-brainer at this point, in my opinion. Like, I don't know why you wouldn't get it, especially when it includes Xbox Live for the $14.99 version.
Right, for Ultimate, yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, so then the other big part of this, which Phil did, this was in the beginning, and this I want to bring up. This is going to be the part where all the YouTube commenters turn on me, and all the tweets turn on me, which happens every now and again. But you know,
this is pitchfork.
You brought it? Oh, good. Yeah. Okay.
No.
So, all right. Phil did address the elephant in the room, which is exclusivity. Now, I saw so many YouTube comments. I saw so many tweets about this that said he was crystal clear. We're golden. I don't think he was. I actually had to go back and read the transcript, because I heard it and I went, wait a second. This is still vague. I went back and read it. Here's exactly what Phil Spencer said. He says, obviously, I can't sit here and say every Bethesda game is exclusive, because we know that's not true. There's contractual obligations that we're going to see through, as we always do in every one of these instances. So he's referring there to Ghostwire Tokyo and Deathloop. Says, we have games that exist on other platforms, and we're going to go support those games on the platforms they're on. There's communities of players. We love those communities, and we'll continue to invest in them. And even in the... Here's the key part that I feel like people just selectively chose not to hear.
I think there's another key part, but...
Okay, we'll keep going.
I'm excited
even
to get
in the future, there may... In the future, there may be things that have contractual things or legacy on different platforms that will go do. So I think there's a clear leaving of the door open for not everything to be exclusive necessarily. But he then comes back, the next words out of his mouth are, but if you're an Xbox customer, the thing I want you to know is that this is about delivering great exclusive games for you that ship on platforms where Game Pass exists. That's our goal. That's why we're doing this. That's the root of this partnership that we're building, and the creative capability that we're able to bring to market for Xbox customers is going to be the best it's ever been for Xbox after we're done here. Destin, go ahead.
So the second paragraph is what everybody is really reading between the lines on, right?
Yeah.
He's being clear. He's like, I have to play nice right now, but I'm also done playing nice. And what he's saying is, this is about delivering great exclusive games for you that ship on platforms where Game Pass exists. So if you have Game Pass, you're going to be golden with Bethesda games, right? And they're going to be exclusive to that platform. So something's going on there. There's definitely more there that we're not aware of, or that he's working on behind the scenes to bring Game Pass to maybe more places. I don't know, but that's been speculated. And it's for Xbox gamers. So he was pretty clear that this deal is about Xbox games. So when we talk about the legacy stuff, what I hear, Ryan, is potentially that means, like, if Fallout 76 is going to continue to be supportive, of course, they're going to continue to release that content cross-platform. If there's ever a Fallout 5, potentially that's still cross-platform. I would argue that might be one that ends up Xbox exclusive. Same with Elder Scrolls, because it was exclusive for Oblivion, right? Something like Starfield, though, no ambiguity whatsoever. I truly believe that will be an Xbox exclusive with his verbiage and his tone there. And that was my takeaway from the whole thing. People know there's contractual obligations for several of the games like Deathloop that are going to come out cross-platform. I think we're going to see the end of that in the next 5 years.
Yeah, I mean, again, I'm not trying to rain on anybody's parade. I just want to just temper everyone's expectations a little, because to what you said, Destin, it's the fact that he said in the future there may be things that will go do. I mean, that's where I'm just like, okay. And hopefully it may just be he's referring to Indiana Jones right there, because that got announced before this Bethesda acquisition with Microsoft was finalized. That may be a deal in place with Disney and Lucasfilm, where it's going to come to PS5. Although, you know, I know a lot of people in the community would point to Spider-Man on PS4 and PS5 and say, well, no, not necessarily. Look, you can have a major IP like that that's a platform exclusive. But I just want to make sure people just keep that little door open in your mind just in case, so that if anything ever does come up, whether it's just Indiana Jones or whether it could be other things too, that Phil didn't, you know, there was that caveat that he threw in there. Miranda, am I insane?
No. I mean, there's also probably things we don't know about. Like, Bethesda does like to do surprises, be like, bam, we have a game for you tomorrow. So that could be a thing that they have, and they would maybe have contractual obligations for that. Sometimes when I hear about the contractual obligation thing, I think about Starfield, and I'm like, man, how funny would it be if there was a bidding war for some sort of exclusivity or time exclusive for Starfield? And like, if it were like Sony and Microsoft going down at it, like just throwing down their bids, and then Microsoft, well, you know what? We're just going to buy all of Bethesda. That would be really funny. But that's just, I was just thinking about that as we discussed it. But yeah, I mean, there's a flexibility there, which I appreciate. And I think we all know and have seen with Minecraft and other titles that Microsoft has technically exclusivity for, but do put on other platforms because it's most advantageous. And so I know we've talked about exclusivity to the ground at this point, and at the end of the day, we're not going to know what's going to happen until they say so. So we can, but it is kind of fun to pick at these words, be like, all right, sorry, Phil, we are dissecting everything. The scalpels are out. We've got the pins and needles.
I mean, they review this stuff, you know.
Yeah.
Phil's not like literally scripted there, but they've reviewed what they're going to say before. Oh, yeah. So they have chosen their words carefully.
I feel like Phil, well, obviously Phil knows what he's doing. He's not going to say something that would put them in a precarious situation. So it is definitely something that's thought of ahead. And I think if anything, even like the bolded, that we'll go do that you have from this quote is just a point of like, trying to say, hey, we're trying to leave things open because there are probably going to be things in the future that won't just be pure exclusive. But
I guess as an Xbox fan, and I want to get to you here in a second, Cam, my fear is I hope he's not subtly referring to Starfield there, which I'm glad you brought up, Miranda, because you know, Sony got to before Microsoft could write that $7.5 billion check. Sony got to Ghostwire Tokyo. They got to Deathloop.
Exactly.
And we know that Starfield is also kind of in that group of near term releases. Like it's one of the next big games coming up for all of Bethesda collectively. Whether Starfield ends up being this holiday or even next holiday, it is soonish. So I hope Starfield, I feel, is. It is the ace up Phil Spencer's sleeve at this point, because it's a new Todd Howard IP, a new Bethesda role-playing game. I mean, that's the kind of game that if Sony didn't sneak in some exclusivity arrangement before that acquisition happened, Starfield is a game that could move consoles and move or at least Game Pass subscriptions for PC players. Like that's a game that could bring people into your ecosystem.
We know little about it, and Fallout 76 didn't go so hot for them. So it could also be a dud.
Well, but that was not a Todd Howard game.
Fair.
Todd Howard did not direct that game. This will be the first Starfield's the first Todd Howard game since Fallout 4.
Four.
So it's been a while. Cam, what do you think of all this? Are we making a mountain out? Am I making a mountain out of a molehill here?
Well, you know, you did mention the thing with contractual things or legacy on different platforms, and the thing that makes me the series that makes me go into mind is like, okay, do you mean like Elder Scrolls 6 when that eventually comes out? Do you mean like Fallout, like the next Fallout game? Because those do have legacy on different platforms, but again, like this second paragraph where it's just like, if you're a Xbox customer, the thing I want you to know is that this is about delivering great exclusive games for you to ship on platforms where Game Pass exists. So it's just like, it is kind of like muddy in the middle there. I kind of side with Destin. I still think that, like, after, you know, either Starfield, if there is some sort of exclusivity, basically whichever comes out last, Starfield or Indiana Jones, I'm assuming Indiana Jones will probably be the later game there.
For sure.
Like, I think all the games that are, like, meant for console and PC are going to be exclusive on wherever Game Pass exists.
Yeah. I mean, again, not to rain on parades here, but because if Phil Spencer wanted to be crystal clear, he would have looked into the camera and said, after Ghostwire Tokyo and Deathloop, which were already under arrangement before we came in, every Bethesda game moving forward will be exclusive to where Game Pass lives. That would have been the crystal clear way to say it. But he left the door open. That's all I'm saying.
I don't think they can be crystal clear right now, because I bet there's still stuff that's like halfway in the works with Sony at the moment. And that's why they can't be crystal clear about what he means, right? Yeah. Once that's done, I think they're going to start being really crystal clear, including at that summer event when they are going to tell us what is exclusive to Xbox. And he said a few other things. He said, like, we don't want to do 15 games that do the same thing. We want to do, you know, 15 games that try different things. Like, they want to be experimental, and that's why they're excited about a company like Arkane that sort of thinks outside the box and tries some, you know, really, really unique stuff. And, you know, I don't think it would be crazy if the next Elder Scrolls was Xbox exclusive. You don't get the hammer on Microsoft and Xbox for not having exclusives for 5 years running to not have them answer back. There was a time when Xbox almost died at the launch of the Xbox One. Microsoft was ready to pull the plug and kill it, right? Phil has put in the work and has made this acquisition for Bethesda, and he is not playing, in my opinion. They are going to make as many things exclusive to Xbox as they possibly can. And, you know, I understand why a PlayStation fan or a PS5 fan would be unhappy about that. Xbox just has such a different strategy than what PlayStation is doing, though. And this is the exclusive part of the strategy that I think they're really, really going to build upon. Especially, so, like, yeah, we have this muddy water period for the next 5 years. But going beyond that, it's going to be crystal clear what's going to be exclusive on Xbox.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I mean, you're absolutely right that we do still have to kind of navigate the transition, I guess, of anything that may have, you know, any business Bethesda may have done prior to the deal to, you know, seeing all that stuff through. And that's really just the question, I think, is what are those things? You know, is it Indiana Jones? Is it anything else? You know, or is it any of it? Is it none of it? So that's still a little up in the air. But yes, by and large here, the bottom line is there is so much talent now that is part of the Xbox family. You've got the creators of Wolfenstein, who, by the way, you want to connect the dots back to Xbox history. The creators of Wolfenstein are also the creators of one of a game that I would probably put in the top five greatest original Xbox games ever, and that was The Chronicles of Riddick, Escape from Butcher Bay. That core team from Starbreeze left and some years later and formed Machine Games. So it is the same talent that did Riddick that has gone on to do Wolfenstein and now are moving on to Indiana Jones. So you've got that talent. You've got id Software, which has, you know, completely reinvented itself after the departures of, you know, John Carmack, John Romero, most of the original crew over the years. And now with Marty Stratton and Hugo Martin have completely reinvented Doom in a way that is as fresh and is as fun as ever. It's Doom Eternal's my favorite first person shooter of recent memory. Unless Half-Life Alyx is what we're putting it in that category, it's a VR game. But the point is, id Software is absurdly talented. The final DLC, story DLC, is dropping this week for that Ancient Gods Part 2. You know, you've got Shinji Mikami and Tango Gameworks. They're doing Ghostwire Tokyo right now, which, yes, is going to debut on PlayStation 5, but it'll get to Xbox at some point, and that game looks super cool. You've got one of Arkane's teams doing Deathloop, again, the other PS5 timed exclusive. But there's so much going on with Bethesda. There's so much talent. And to your point, Destin, it's diverse talent as far as the kinds of games they make. It's really insane. And then of course, at the top of the list is Starfield, and then Elder Scrolls 6 looming after that. So just so much to look forward to. Really enjoyed that hour and 20-minute roundtable where they introduced all the Bethesda teams in video presentations. Really, really great stuff. All right, let's talk more Game Pass, because Game Pass just, it's not even a spigot anymore. It's just like a waterfall rush of games that keep coming. Miranda, I know there's one of your favorites here, I believe.
My favorite game of all time.
Yeah.
Which is crazy. Finally. Okay, so yeah. So new coming to Game Pass the week of March 15th, which is this week, is we have Undertale, which is out today, which is my favorite game of all time. I own it on every console. I own it on the Vita, PC, PlayStation, Switch, everywhere. And now I can have it on Xbox, which is so exciting because it took forever. So you can also get that on the cloud, console, and PC, which is really cool. So if you have it on PC, you can just download with Game Pass Ultimate. We also have Empire of Sin on March 18th, Nier Automata on March 18th for PC. I think that's already on console, yeah. So it's also
I'm playing PC. It right now, personally.
Yeah, I remember because I just bought it, and then it came to console. I was like, dang it. then we have Star Wars Squadrons, shout out to Mitch Dyer, on March 18th, so that'll be on console.
That's a nice ad, too. Like, if you missed it last, it just came out in October. It's like, it's only been out for 6 months.
Yeah, these are not just like little, oh, that's an interesting game. Like, these are pretty big games. We also have Torchlight 3 on March 18th for PC. Then on the week of March 22nd, we have Genesis Noir, which looks like a very cool adventure game on console and PC on March 25th. Then Octopath Traveler, which is kind of sneaking up there. It's like, hey,
that's huge.
Yeah,
I'm going to stop you right there. Sounds like Cam too. I love Octopath Traveler. I fell in love with that game from the moment they had the reveal trailer at one of the Nintendo Switch presentations. It is, if you haven't seen it, it has a 16-bit like square RPG look, but in like kind of 3D, and with real-time like global illumination lighting. It's incredible. Yeah, it turns out the game's really fun too. It's like it's got all these great individual character stories, the eight people in your party. Cam, are you a fan of this as well?
Yeah, I really like Octopath Traveler. I think you're bigger on it than I am personally, but I definitely think it's one of it's a top 10 JRPG on the Switch, you know, before it came, you know, now it's out on Xbox. I think visually it is absolutely stunning. I think the combat is very, very fun. The story, wasn't the biggest fan of, but I still think that it's 100% a must play. Like, I wouldn't say it's a must play JRPG, but I definitely think it's like if you're looking for a good JRPG to play, that's there, yeah, right there.
It's kind of, I would compare it story wise a little bit, and this may make Destin's head explode, I'm not sure, but kind of to Mass Effect 2 in that. The overarching story of Octopath Traveler is not great, but the individual character stories are awesome.
That makes sense.
Okay. Yes. Because the story is like the party isn't like in one big story. It's just more like they travel together and then they have their one-off stories where none of the other party is really relevant to the actual narrative. But it's still really, really great.
And it just, this came out of nowhere. This was a Switch exclusive for a year and all of a sudden, hey, it's coming to Xbox and Game Pass. So I'm
there's
very stoked.
Themes in those stories too. Like, it's not like a kid's story thing. Like, there was somebody who was basically like an indentured servant that you free. I think that's one of the storylines that I did for the singer character. And, you know, that was, I was like, whoa, this goes some pretty dark places. And I appreciated that actually. And I really like Octopath a lot.
And the music's really good too. So I really encourage everybody to download that and give it a try on Game Pass.
Yeah. So that
what else,
was,
Amanda?
Yeah. So Octopath was previously on PC as well as the Switch. And now it was on now it will be on the Xbox and on PC with Games Pass on March 25th. And then we also have Pillars of Eternity 2, Deadfire, Ultimate Edition on March 25th for PC. So if you want another very long game, you got your options. Then we have Superland on March 25th on PC. I don't know what that one is, but it looks colorful. And then we have Yakuza 6, The Song of Life on March 25th as well. And that's coming to the cloud, console, and PC.
You can literally play every Yakuza game now. Well, the remastered versions.
Yep.
Yeah, on Xbox. I started Yakuza 0 and was pleasantly surprised and thankful that I finally started playing that game because it's really good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a series I need to get to myself.
Yeah, I just downloaded one of them. I forget which one I downloaded, but I have to play through another game first. And then Yakuza.
I've seen a lot of friends on my feed that have gotten into Yakuza because of Game Pass, because they're just there. So I think one of those, what's the word I'm looking for? Almost like a happy side effect of Game Pass. Like, it's not just that the game's there; it's that, you know, you can put a whole series of stuff there, and people will just get into it, and then they become a fan for when the next one comes out.
And Todd also pointed that out during the Bethesda roundtable. He's like, you know, we saw a huge number of people hop onto Elder Scrolls, and a lot of people hop onto Fallout 76 because of Game Pass. It's really really cool.
Yep,
and also worth mentioning,
by the way.
I was also going to mention, like, and for those that like are getting into the Yakuza series, let's not forget that Judgment, which is a spinoff of the Yakuza series, it's in the same like world, same developer, is also coming to Xbox Series X and S later this year.
Cool. And then, so the week of March 29th, we have Narita Boy on March 30th. So it's going to be cloud, console, and PC. And then we have Outriders, which was one that everyone was talking about last week, on April 1st. So that's cloud and console. And it will be day one on Game Pass.
It's awesome. I mean, a major third-party release on day one for Game Pass. Destin, you've played a little bit of Outriders, I think.
Yeah, the story is, I would say, not great, but the gameplay is really, really, really fun, especially how I'm Trickster, so it deals a lot with time manipulation. They have like a Vanguard dash ability where you can teleport behind enemies, and it has really, really interesting combat mechanics where it kind of starts building upon each other as you unlock abilities. I understand the draw of it. We'll see if it has legs. I'm just cautious about any game like that now because everything gets compared to Destiny, and this one seems good, but every time we say that, it turns out like people just tear through it and then we don't really hear from it again. So yeah, we'll see how they do. It is interesting that it's not coming to PC via Game Pass. I think that's probably because like they're already locked in with Epic and Steam, right?
Makes sense. Yeah.
So do you want to play Outriders for $1 for a month if you don't have Game Pass yet? Or do you want to pay $60 for it?
Well, and actually to that point, Destin, I saw, you know, some people, I don't know, you mentioned this earlier, there are some people out there that just have like a bug up there behind about trying to poo-poo Game Pass, and I don't understand why. And I saw somebody posting like, well, it's on Game Pass until they take it away and then you don't have it anymore. It's like, well, okay, if they do that, even if they did that, even if it was only on Game Pass from April and then they pulled it on May 1st, you download it, play it for a month, and then you can buy it at a discount. You get to buy Game Pass games at a discount. So that's still a pretty darn good deal.
Yeah, and I would say most of the games on Game Pass, like, that's just, you pick one of them and that's probably what you end up playing for that month. And if you play through two games, you have paid for your Game Pass for the year. Two.
Right. Yeah.
Maybe three if you'd buy the $14.99 one.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's a good point. And I just think, I mean, the more the first party games are going to be crucial to Game Pass and bringing people into Game Pass as time goes on. I mean, we're still waiting on all those first party garden that Microsoft has been watering and tilling and caring for to start actually sprouting. We're not quite there yet, but I think it's equally important, maybe even more so, to get big third party releases like this on day one, because, you know, game prices seem like they're going to be going up to $70 across the board for the most part this generation. So if you're looking to, you know, not everybody, most people have not chosen a PS5 or a Series X yet. They're on PS4 or Xbox One. And as time goes on, if you're going to make the choice of where to go in the next generation, and you see, well, you know, you've got big third party stuff like Outriders that will launch into Game Pass. Like, yeah, you might start to really lean Xbox because you think, well, I could pay $70 for that on Sony, or I could just get it as part of my Game Pass subscription with all these first party games that Microsoft is starting to crank out on the Xbox side. So I think this is you know, regardless of how Outriders turns out, sort of Metacritic wise, review score wise, all that stuff, I think it's a really great sign for Microsoft to get this major day one third party support. I promised I would do this.
Go ahead. I think you're making an interesting point. That's something that I've been thinking about when I've seen people on like Twitter talk about like how Outriders being day one on like Game Pass is just like as a negative, because I think that there are some preemptive notions on how it's going to do either critically or public reception, that like, oh, it's just kind of like a filler game, like a filler Game Pass game. And I think that one, I don't think like that should be the main focus when you think about like all of the great games that are on Game Pass. Like, but I also think that there is this, I personally believe, and I hope that Xbox proves me wrong, is that like a game like Outriders, I think is kind of probably be like the best that we're going to see in the sense of like scope or like anticipation when it comes to a major third party title that will get a day one release on Game Pass. So like, I don't want people to get their expectations like really, really high that like some highly anticipated, like multi-platform game is like, you know, like the next Assassin's Creed is like, oh, day one on Game Pass. Like, don't expect that. Like, do not expect that. I hope I'm proven wrong one day and they just get like some big heavy hitter. But I just want, like, I think that this should be something where people should kind of rein in their expectations.
The demo seemed to, you know, they put out a big chunk of the game as a demo, which people seem to be enjoying. So we'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see how this one ends up landing when the release date rolls around on April 1st. I promised I would do this in the beginning, and we just got talking about other stuff. So I want to stop and talk about this guy for a minute, the Xbox wireless headset. I very much encourage you to either read the IGN review, which is written by a gentleman by the name of Mike Epstein, on the site, or you can just watch a video review of the same thing on YouTube, which I recorded it, but because our freelancer didn't have the production capability to do it, but I did not write it. However, I have been using it, and I would echo Mike's sentiment on it. We gave it an 8 out of 10, called it great, and yeah, I definitely recommend this. If you're like me, where you prefer wireless headphones for your gaming, you know, maybe you're like me and you play mostly when your family's gone to bed, or you just don't have like a great sound bar, which I don't. I just have TV sound. And these are really good. So number one, they are comfortable. They feel good after a good amount of time. I mean, they're a really solid build. I like the minimalism on these a lot, where it's, you know, they're just black with it's just a subtle Xbox logo on, in fact, just one side, not even the other side. And then just this subtle green ring around the outside, and everything's just integrated. You have, there's two buttons. There's the power on button, which also doubles as the sync button, which you only need once, obviously, to set it up. Really only once, because then with you can Bluetooth it to your phone at the same time, which I've also done. And then there's a mute microphone button, but the mic just unfolds like that, puts it back up when you're done with it. It sounds really good. I mean, that's the most important thing. They're comfortable. They sound good. $100. It's, you know, they're not like top of the line, you know, $300-$400 cans, but they are just for the price. I really think the sound quality, the convenience, the comfort, it's just my guess is that Microsoft had a price objective here of let's make the best wireless headphones we can for $100. And I think they've done a tremendous job of that. I guess the other thing I should mention is I really like the volume control is just right here on the side. So it's volume over here, really, and then cool. It's a game chat mix over here, which is really, you know, you're not fumbling around for anything. You're not looking for any like little tiny knobs or dials. So it's just really well put together. So I know they're sold out across the board at the moment, because I had checked, but keep checking, because I think they are worth hunting down. I was bummed that the Xbox Series X sacrificed its optical port, which in fact Sony did too. It's not just Microsoft. They both sacrificed the optical port when I would just run my optical wire across the floor for my Astros that I've been using for years and years and years, which I've always loved. Go ahead, Destin.
There's the workaround I do, Ryan, is your TV probably has optical out. So that's how I do it.
But that's a whole other thing. I would rather spend $100 on these. I'll just put it that way. This is the easier, nicer solution. I have not had them long enough to test the battery life. Our reviewer says, I think our review said, he said they were close to as advertised, like I want to say maybe like 15-ish hours, which is still pretty darn good. You know, so even if you play all day, boom, you're good all day, and then you charge them overnight. So recommended. Great. Really good headphones. Yeah, great job, Microsoft. Hardware awesome. Team continues to kill it.
I got my pre-order in for one, so mine comes in, I think, in the next 2 days or so. So I'm excited.
Sweet. We're not done yet. We've still got some time. I know we're going to be, Destin's got to go in about 15, but the rest of us have a little more time. Let's see how much can get through.
The meeting's at 12:30, so.
Oh, perfect. Well, the last major story I wanted to get to before we move to the loot box and the unlock block trivia, which I definitely want Destin to get in on. So we'll get to that here in a second. But I love this little anecdote about Halo Infinite. We got a little new something about Halo Infinite. You can, if you've been following Infinite, as I know, you know, Miranda, you have as well, you know, the ring is under construction, right, Miranda? We talked a little bit about that with the guys at 343.
Yeah.
and so the ring is kind of in various states of repair, and you can knock enemies off of it entirely. Like, actually knock a bad guy literally off of the Halo ring. Troy Mashburn, looks like I'm 40, I'm gonna need glasses soon. Troy Mashburn, the gameplay director for Infinite, was responding on a fan Q&A about, can you knock enemies off of the ring? And he said, the answer is yes. I can tell you that just recently I was playing and I happened to be driving with a Scorpion tank. I came around the corner and was face to face with a Wraith. And just out of pure luck, pure coincidence, I managed to push the Wraith over the edge and just watched it slowly tilt back and just fall into the abyss, which was amazing, unexpected, and just such a cool moment that happened. So absolutely, you can push things off of the edge. It's going to be difficult, but if you can manage to time it just right, you're going to see it, which, Destin, that opens up a lot of interesting multiplayer possibilities too.
Yeah, for sure. I'm pushing all y'all off the edge of that ring the first chance I get. I'm going to be like, there's a secret collectible over here, Miranda. It's right on the edge of the ring, and then bam, ghost, right off the ring.
The trick, you're driving the Warthog. You have your friends come in, and you just drive everyone off the ring. There you go.
Got to get that gameplay clip.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, Miranda.
Guys, I have to capture something. Hop on this Warthog really quick.
It could be a Wiki Game Help nightmare if they hide like some, like a skull or something, like where you have to make some crazy joke.
They will. Of course they will.
I love to sit on the edge of a cliff and I'm like meticulously walk every pixel. I'm like, all right, is there? Nope, there's nothing there. Nope, there's no collectibles. Still nothing. Nope, but is that a ledge? Let's check it. You jump down. Nope, that was not a ledge. I've done it before, but not basically.
I think in Halo 5, when we were working on that, you found one that was like a crashed ship that just you easily could have missed or something with a skull there. I don't remember, but I remember you found it and it was really, I never would have found it in a million years.
A lot. I've broken many games. but there's also some other news with this, right, Ryan? Some unfortunate news.
Oh, yeah. So I think there's a larger conversation here, which we, this is the perfect venue to have it. Cam, let me set this up by asking you, what's your favorite Halo campaign, or just even Halo in general? Like, what's your favorite one?
Okay, so my favorite Halo campaign is Halo 2.
Okay.
But my favorite Halo as a full experience, as a full package, is Halo 3.
Okay. So I'm glad you said that. So that's
the right answer.
And, well, everybody has a different answer. And so we've heard 343 time and again. I mean, as Miranda and I have done, we did our interviews last summer, where the message that they're hammering on is trying to recapture that sort of sense of wonder from Halo 1. I mean, that's the whole point of the freeform Halo ring. And I get that, and that's awesome. But this little tidbit that we also got that Miranda was alluding to, where it's confirmed there will be no dual wielding and no playing as elites in multiplayer. You'll just be playing as Spartans. So, you know, you could take that as, oh, that's, you know, that's bad news. But to me, what it says is it just kind of illuminates what 343 is going for. And I think it seems to me that they're going for the sense of wonder and exploration that you had in Halo 1. But it seems like they're going for an actual gameplay feel of Halo 3, because they're bringing equipment back and there's no dual wielding. So it feels like almost a fusion of 1 and 3 to me is what they're going for. Destin?
Yeah, Ryan, I don't think it's gameplay feel. I think they're going for gameplay balance overall, because I think once you hop into PvP, dual wielding introduces like so many different combinations and different ways that people can manipulate the power of the weapons that you're able to wield in that fashion. Yeah, it can be a lot of fun, but I think making a balanced sandbox where you're going to have standouts, but they've probably worked on tuning those weapons to the point that PvP is just in a place that they're happy with and they can refine over the years. And I have to imagine that dual wielding, they probably tried it out and they're just like, okay, things get a little bit broken with this once we like put it in the hands of pros. So let's keep it, you know, single. And that decision was probably made like a long time ago. I don't think this is new for them, but definitely new for us. This is going to be a little controversial. I think dual wielding at the time was really, really interesting. I don't think today it is necessarily impactful. I think you can have a great game where you use one weapon at a time. I don't think dual wielding is necessary to make Halo a great game. You know,
you don't want to see your enemies explode with the needler? 1,000 little cuts?
I can just use the needler.
Yeah. That's true. But another thing that, like, I think to point out is that like there aren't that many weapons like in Halo 2, for example, that you could dual wield with. You know what I mean? Like out of the overall weapons that you could choose, there was like the plasma, well, like most of the Covenant weapons, and then like the SMG.
SMG and the plasma.
And yeah, that was it. You know what I mean? Yeah. So
So for me, it's more about like campaign stuff. So is this specifically for
campaign wise is fun.
It's the game. Yeah. Okay. Multiplayer. It's the whole thing.
Okay. Yeah. Cause for multiplayer. Yeah. I totally agree, Dustin. Like I'm always about balance and having that good fine tuned shooter experience in multiplayer. I want that above all else. That's why I don't like Destiny's multiplayer, but that's another conversation. And I think if we have to give up dual wielding for an excellent multiplayer, that's fine. I also don't necessarily mind playing as elites in multiplayer either. I think, honestly, it's fine just going in as Spartans. But I do love the nostalgia of dual wielding. That was such a fun thing. I remember that. I had so much fun with that.
I mean, remember the reaction that we all had when dual wielding was first shown in the E3 2000.
You can hold two guns at the same time.
It's so good.
Yeah, it's fine. And it totally makes sense, of course, with equipment. Like, that's going to be such a big thing. Chief's got to have a hand free. But, yeah.
Also, also just mentioning the elite thing, just as someone who played a lot of Halo 3, I'm actually kind of glad that you can't play as elites because when I play Halo 3 multiplayer at this point, I only play SWAT. And in Halo 3, if people would play as elites simply to make it harder for people to get headshots. And I'm just like, so now I'm just like, I'm good. Like, get them out. Get them out of here.
Oh man. Well, my hope is that it's that, you know, because seemingly like just my little theory on this, that it's, they're trying to combine bits of one with bits of three and seemingly ignoring two. I'm hoping the multiplayer maps will be of Halo 2 quality. That's where I hope that that Halo 2's influence enters the equation. Because that would be my one complaint about what is otherwise phenomenal Halo 5 multiplayer. I don't think the maps are quite up to the standard that the series has always been known for amazing maps. And I don't think 5 necessarily had Ryan, too many of those.
I think you're dangerously close to giving away our answers to the loot box questions. You just want to go into that and we could talk about this more?
Yeah, that's a good segue, actually. Let's do exactly that. Jeff from New Jersey. Actually, let me preface this. So the Yappa experiment on IGN has come to a close. I want to thank everybody who did send in Yappas. We just didn't get a lot of traction on it, to be honest. So it was a thing we tried, so we're not doing it. But I would still really like to do the video loot box question. I really liked what it added to the podcast. I loved having a community member, an unlocked fan, be a part of the show each week. So if you'd like to do that, I guess all I can do is ask and see if anybody's interested. But just post yourself on Twitter. Just do your loot box question on Twitter and then just tag me in it. And then I'll see it and we can paste you in here and get you put into the show. So if you've got a loot box question for the panel, tweet it at me via video and we will feature you on an upcoming episode. With that, Jeff in New Jersey, my home state, says, I'm new to the Xbox world and could use some advice from the Unlocked gang. To explain my situation, I became a born-again PlayStation gamer in 2019 after having not owned a console since the PS2 days.
Wow.
I was able to snag a PS5 in January, which has been wonderful, but for a while I've been interested in the Xbox ecosystem as well. Backward compatibility is very attractive, so I recently ordered a Series S. It seemed like the perfect secondary system for a person like me who owns zero physical games for Xbox and wants to try out what PS5 can't provide. That's the Series S and Game Pass. This is, Jeff is exactly Microsoft's strategy, part of it, come to life here.
Exactly what we talked about last year.
Yes. He says, I'm mostly a fan of single-player adventures. I'm very excited to play Ori, but I feel like I'd be silly not to try out Halo as well. My only experience with Halo is the first one when I was a kid. I would go over to my friend's house and play multiplayer with him. Now that I can finally do the single player campaigns, because of course he's got Master Chief Collection on Game Pass, he says, which should I start with? Halo 1, 5, somewhere in the middle? And he says, I'm hoping you disagree with each other about this because that would make for some fun conversation. And he says, P.S., what's up with these asymmetrical joysticks? Well, welcome to the superior controller.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There's so many people that tell me, oh, symmetrical sticks are so much better. I'm like, no, they're not. No, they're not. Asymmetrical is so much better. So much better.
I will say, for first-person shooters, they're for sure better.
I'm so glad we all agree on that because I was just like, please, please, I don't want to debate this.
Welcome to Unlocked.
Well,
you're in the right place, Cam.
Yes. Miranda, let me go your way first. Jeff in New Jersey, where should he start with Halo campaigns?
Easy. Halo 1. I think we won't have a lot of disagreement on this. I think the Halo story, it's just one of those that builds on each other. If you start out of order, you're going to be probably confused because you're not going to have a lot of important introductions. You're not going to get a lot of the basic lore details of like why things are a threat or not. So definitely start with the first one.
Yeah, I think there are probably, as I go around the table, probably going to be two answers to this. Halo 5 is, you should absolutely not start with Halo 5 because you will not want to play any of the other campaigns. Destin, are you in agreement with Miranda here, or are you going to say
I'm not actually, because he said he played Halo 1 already. So
no, I would say,
pardon?
I played the multiplayer.
Yeah, so I would say if you didn't get to play the campaign over at your friends when you were young, or you want to re-experience it and sort of relive that nostalgia sort of feeling, start with Halo 1. But otherwise, I would highly recommend the redone Halo 2. Halo 2, I think you could also start with, and you're not really missing too much. I won't spoil Halo 1.
We at Destin like Aerie. Wow. Yeah.
I won't spoil Halo 1, but guess what? You're fighting the Covenant still in Halo 2. A lot of important stuff happened in Halo 2.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow, we're going that bare bones on what the story is. Oh, you fight Covenant in Halo 1. Oh, you fight Covenant in Halo 2. That's Halo.
I'm being a little incendiary on purpose because my main argument is I have a feeling that he played through Halo 1 already, so I think he should go to Halo 2.
I think it's always a good day to play through Halo 1 again. Just throwing it out there.
The cinematics are phenomenal. I really, really like what they did with the gameplay and improvements that they made. Halo 1, you're getting the anniversary edition, right? And it's rough. Like, it's the best Halo 1 experience that you can get, but it's just... it's just blocky, sort of, and I don't want his experience to be negative. I want him to be blown away by Halo with 2 and hooked.
I feel like you could understand that it's an older game, though, is my defense. Like, if I go back to play the Mario 3, whatever, like, I have to understand that I'm going back to an older game. If you went back to play Mass Effect 1,
I'm not saying Halo 1 is bad. Halo 1 is one of my favorite games of all time. I'm saying if we want to blow this guy away and get him really hooked on the Halo franchise, what am I going to recommend? I'm going to recommend the best looking of the retro series, Halo 2, because the blur cinematics look phenomenal. If you want to see the improvements they made, you can just hit the button to do the comparison on the fly. You can do that with Halo 1 Anniversary also.
Yeah.
It's really, really neat. And I would say Halo 2 is a safe starting point also. If you've never played any of them, the answer is Halo 1. Never played it.
I was not expecting Halo 2. So the Cam, what do you think? We'll see if somebody's going to say the other contender here.
I'm not, but I feel like, oh, wait, hold on. I think I know what you're going to say. And I think it is fair. And I assume you're saying Halo Reach.
It's devil's advocate. I would also, I'm in total agreement that you should start with Halo 1 because I'm in the minority. I don't hold Reach in as high of an esteem as a lot of other people do.
Oh, okay. Wow. I love Reach. I think we all love Reach to a certain degree, but like, no, I think you should start with 1, but Reach is a prequel, but it is a game that's later on. So, but I would just play. I'm one of those people that I'm like, play them in release order. Like they released in order for a reason. So, I would start with Halo 1. I recently replayed it like a few months ago, with the Master Chief Collection. It's great still. So definitely hop into Halo 1. I would say
those games are short, right, Cam? When you played, how long was Halo 1 when you played it?
So I played it with co-op Legendary, so it probably took me a little bit longer than a normal playthrough. But if you play through on normal, get through it in like 10 hours, 12 hours, I'd say.
Fast. Yeah, if you do two longer sittings.
Other than a day or two.
Yeah, so I think the two, we're all in agreement that it's one. It's still the place to start with. But if the other option is to go in Halo chronology, in the timeline, which would be Reach, 1, 2, ODST, 3, 4, 5. But I think
that's something you do after you've played through them all, though, right?
Maybe. I mean,
like, that's something you do as a mega fan. I don't think that's something you would need to do as a
new player.
That's
what I'm doing right now, kind of, except I skip Reach.
I would probably go, I mean, I think if you went, I would just maybe not play Reach first. I would probably go, I would still go like 1, 2, ODST, 3, and then maybe Reach, and then so mostly in release order, I guess, is probably where I would land with it. But Jeff, good stuff. Welcome to the Xbox family and have fun with Halo. All right, we've got a few minutes here, just enough time for the Unlock Block Trivia Challenge. Let's see. Destin did not get on the board before he ducked away for paternity leave.
I think we only did like one or two episodes. Make it sound like I don't know anything.
Well, I'll tell you, you don't have a lot of ground to make up because it was
It was ugly. It was ugly.
Damn, you're my hope.
It's been a rough go for the panel here. We have Miranda with 2 points, Brandon 1, Cam 1, and Brian Altano picked up 1 last week in his appearance here.
Even Brian got 1?
A chance destined to get right in the game despite your absence. Andrew asks this. Xbox Live featured a series of design changes from the original Xbox to the initial Xbox 360 release, and he says, RIP, the Blades layout. Press F to pay your respects. One of the more inconsequential features, which actually I have to, I love this from Andrew because I had not thought about this in years, but he notes one of the more inconsequential features of the Blades on Xbox Live was the ability to pick your gamer zone in your profile. Theoretically, being able to give people a quick look at what type of gamer you were, and also theoretically able to matchmake you with people in your zone. There were 4 zones to choose from. Which of the following is the fake zone? So 3 of these are real gamer zones that you could choose. One of them is not. We have pro, A, pro, B, family, C, underground, D, amateur. So I will go, I'll go Destin's way first since he's been off the show for a while.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I was pro, but sometimes I would change it to underground when I wanted to be edgy. So, I'm pretty sure those two are real. I think, if I remember correctly, the answer would be family or amateur as the fake one trying to, trick us or whatever. But maybe I'm remembering wrong about pro. I'm going to say that B, family is my answer. I don't know why. I feel like that's the answer.
All right.
I don't think they were thinking about that at that time too much.
Okay.
For categorizing your gamer level or whatever.
Cam, I know you and Miranda are resident young people on the show. So this is early. You got to dig back to the childhood a little bit here. Early 360 days.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So echoing what Dustin said, I know pro and underground are 2 of them. I know that. And so now my mentality is just like amateur feels like just offensive at this point. So I'm just like, it's like, would they really say amateur? But then Dustin made a good point about the family thing. I'm like, did they have I don't remember. I think it's family. I think I'm going to go with Dustin. I think it's B, family.
Are you sure? Because my other answer was also amateur and it has that negative.
I know, but I'm pretty sure I remember amateur. I'm pretty sure I remember it. I'm pretty
all
sure.
Right.
You're riding with Destin, which is it's a bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see how it pays off for him. Miranda, you have you've had the luxury now of hearing your 2 fellow castmates think through this, talk through this. What do you think?
The amateur.
She sounds confident.
Oh, she knows. She knows.
She sounds confident, and for good reason, she is absolutely correct.
Dang it!
Yeah. I remember these.
Cam,
I was just like, it's amateur. I was like, it's amateur.
I remember playing with these, and I was actually talking about these with some friends recently because we were reminiscing about the Xbox 360 days and the Blades, and they're like, someone was like, do you remember Gamer Zone? I was like, yeah, of course. Because Underground was so funny. And it's like, what's the difference between Underground and Pro? It's like, well, Underground's like, you're edgy and like, you're going to curse.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
So what was the 4th one then?
I don't even remember. I'd have to go back and look.
It was also something sort of basic, but it was an amateur for sure. Cause it'd be weird to have pro.
Like recreation.
Yeah. Yeah. It was something sort of, it's like casual without saying casual in a way.
Well, Andrew, that was a fantastic question. Since I love this. This is the perfect unlock block trivia question. Cause it's not crazy obscure.
There was a cheater zone.
Yeah.
Recreation.
You got caught cheating. You got labeled a cheater.
I'm glad I'm glad my brain still holds some of those classic Xbox memories. Andrew, great job. And if anybody else out there has an unlock block trivia question, I need more good ones to subject the unlock crew to. So you can email them to me The email address is unlocked@ign.com. Include the question, 4 multiple choice answers, and please point out the correct one in your email. And we'll play again next week. But Miranda now has a 2-point lead over the rest of the panel. And with that, it is time to get out of here. I'll quickly mention, after an accidental hiatus, nothing planned, IGN Unfiltered is back. My interview series where I sit down with game developers and talk through their stories. I've actually got one this week and one next week as well. The one that's up right now is with 2 of the leads and also studio co-founders from Cold Iron Studios, the makers of Aliens Fireteam. That's our IGN first game this month. Really interesting conversation there about working with Disney. They also worked on a what was going to be an exclusive Marvel MMO for Xbox 360. If you remember back in the day, it was called Marvel Universe Online. They worked on that. So there's some really neat stories in there. Check out IGN Unfiltered either on the IGN Games YouTube channel or on your favorite podcast feed as well if you just want to listen to it in audio form. Cam.
Yes, sir.
Plug away, my friend.
Okay, I was like, I thought you were going to continue.
Oh, no, sorry, just turning the floor over to you, sir.
No, it's all good. You can follow me on Twitter at CamFinalMix, and I stream on Twitch, twitch.tv/CamFinalMix.
Excellent. Miranda?
Hi, you can find me at Havoc Rose, and that's Havoc with a K, on Twitter, Instagram, Twitch, and pretty much anywhere else you make accounts.
Excellent. And Destin, welcome back. Good to have you back. We missed you, and you're back in time for... You didn't miss the Mass Effect Legendary Edition.
I know.
You timed it well. You had your kid right before. You got a couple months to go there yet. So do you have any immediate things you want to promote, either personal or at IGN?
Yeah, I'm getting back into the swing of things at IGN. Performance reviews are going to be a big focus for me in 2021 for IGN.com. It's like our number one series on IGN. So I'm really, really excited about the growth there. And I can't wait to figure out what we're going to do to elevate that content. And then personal wise, Ryan, I was itching to talk Xbox. So I started doing these like vlog style things on my YouTube channel where I just kind of talk direct to the camera about like my memories of working in the industry or whatever. So you can check those out over at youtube.com/thedestin channel. And I'm still going to be streaming at twitch.tv/destin. When I can, I don't know what that schedule is going to look like, but YouTube has been much easier to manage with a little one who keeps me up all hours of the night. I'll record a lot of those things at like 2 a.m. because I'm just like, well, I can't go to sleep now for half an hour because I need to make sure he's okay. So I'll just record a vlog or whatever and then post it. And the response has been very positive. So thank you.
Excellent. Love hearing that. Well, welcome back. For Cam, Miranda, Destin, and our super producer, Tayo, this week, I'm Ryan. This was Unlocked 486. We'll see you guys next week. Yes, Unlocked is technically over, but, we're all under the same IGN Games YouTube banner now with our friends at Podcast Beyond, NBC, Game Scoop, and Jonathan Dornbush from Podcast Beyond has joined me. Jonathan, what is happening on Podcast Beyond this week? In case anybody wants to go check out your show after checking out ours.
Of course. Ryan, there is so much happening in the world of PlayStation, like talking about what PlayStation should do because of all the Xbox news. It's definitely been a little bit of a quieter time on the PlayStation side, but we'll be talking this week about Jade Raymond's new studio, Haven, and what that partnership with PlayStation might mean for her new game. I just, like to be able to see a Jade Raymond game these days. And then in addition to that, we are going to be talking a lot about sort of what PlayStation's response could be or should be, because Game Pass just seems to get better day by day. And so we kind of want to take a look at the status of PlayStation Now, PlayStation Plus, and sort of see what PlayStation could do to maybe sort of compete in that same space.
Fantastic. Jonathan, thank you so much. Be sure to subscribe to IGN Games on YouTube. That's youtube.com/IGN Games. Your new home for Unlocked Beyond, Game Scoop, NBC, all of our shows right here on IGN. We'll see you next week.